man jumped and dropped his boot. He scrambled up and hopped around on one leg till he was facing Thomas. Thomas was sorry to see that he didn't look friendly at all. He was red in the face and very cross. The policeman wobbled about, trying to keep his balance.
"Disgraceful!" he spluttered. "I didn't sleep a wink last night. It was so quiet and their engines come whistling suddenly behind me. My first day in the country, too!"
He picked up his boot and hopped over to Thomas. "I'm sorry, sir," said Thomas. "I only said good morning." The policeman grunted, and leaning against Thomas' buffer, he put his boot on. He drew himself up and pointed at Thomas.
"Where's your cow catcher?"
he asked accusingly. "But I don't catch cows."
"Don't be funny!"
snapped the policeman. He looked at Thomas' wheels.
"No salt plates either!"
And he wrote in his notebook. "I'm just going to hold the rules, but how do those cover the cow catcher for protecting the house and joining the house down the line?"
"You haven't? So you are dangerous to the public."
"What?
Rubbish!"
said his driver.
"We've been along here hundreds of times and never had an accident."
"Don't mention words!"
the policeman answered. He wrote regular lawbreaker in his book. The fat controller was cross too.
"I am disappointed, Donald," he said. "I did not expect such, clumsiness from you. I had decided to send Douglas back and keep you."
"I'm sorry, sir."
But Donald didn't say what he was sorry for. "We know, don't we?"
"I should think so, too," went on the fat controller indignantly. "You have upset my arrangements. It is most inconvenient. Now, James will have to help with the goods work while you have your tender mended. James won't like that."
James's boiler was nice and warm. The bees swarmed round it happily.
"Buzz off! Buzz off!"
he hissed. He made smoke, but the wind blew it away, and the bees stayed. At last, one settled on his hot smoke box. It burned its feet. The bee thought James had stung it on purpose. It stung James back, right on the nose. Whistled James. He had had enough. So had his driver and fireman. They started without waiting for the guard's whistle. They didn't notice till too late that they had left their train behind. It was the cow's fault. She stood on the track, busily cropping grass. She took no notice of the train. Mike stopped. He wasn't frightened. He had met her before, and she only made him cross. He came slowly forward, whooshing steam from his cylinders. "Shoo! Shoo! Shoo!" The cow just flicked her tail and went on eating. Mike felt exasperated. He tried whistling. He wanted to say,
"Get out of my way, you silly animal!"
But he didn't get far. His second peep turned into a tremendous rush. Mrs. Whistlecap shot up like a rocket and landed in a field beside the line. Henry gently buffered up to the express. While the two drivers talked, his fireman joined his front brake pipe to the coaches. "It's better than we thought, Henry," he said. "The diesel can pull if we keep the brakes off, so the only way we'll have is spam cans goods." "Whew," said Henry.
"That's a mercy."
He was by now feeling rather puffed. In frosty weather, Toby stops before reaching the lane, and rolls from his trucks are still on the slope. This ensures that they can't hold him back, and their weight helps him forward till his wheels can grip the rails again. But Mavis had given the trucks the chance they wanted.
"Hold back! Hold back!" they giggled.
"Grrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrr tracking, but the same thing happened. They sandered the rails to try to dig away the frozen mud, but only broke the shovel, calling the trucks tooting impatiently. Wailed Mason's helpless fury.